I keep you assigned during the time.
Okay, that's great. So, hello everybody. I'm Lisa. I come from the University of Siegen. And this is a joint work with Alex Monras, who was also a co-author in the first of conference today, and Peter Ritter. And this is how I titled my talk, Inductive Supervised Quantum Learning, Why You Are Doing It On Right. And this was supposed to be the paper, the title of the paper, but the journal made us remove this clickbait sentence. Okay, so this is a talk about quantum learning, which is something that some means that people use to refer to problems for learning quantum data by quantum means. Okay, and we have heard about a couple of examples. Yesterday we had the quantum anomaly detection talk by Nana, for instance. Also, last talk of the day by Gerardo in quantum learning is coherent states, which are problems that fall into this category. And I'm interested in this kind of problem, so where the setting is completely quantum. And I'm going to look at the structure of inductive supervised learning algorithms in this setting. So of course I will begin by defining what inductive supervised learning is. We have already seen this in several talks in the conference. So we have like simplest problem, binary classification of data. We have two possible labels, one and two, and data points are just vectors, three-dimensional vectors that live in some feature space. And the problem is as follows. We're given a train set, which consists on a set of pairs, data points with labels, that are sampled from some joint probability distribution, xy, to which what you don't have access to. Then you're given a bunch of test instances, and the task is to attach labels to these guys, to experiment. Okay? So the algorithm will look at this. So I plug in the train set into some training operation here. Out of the training operation, I get some function that maps from the feature space X to the label space Y. And then this function determines the operation that I have to perform over the test instance that I want to classify, okay? So basically, this bounce here, what it does is just apply the function over X prime, I get the label Y prime. And this is supervised learning because we have pre-labeled data, and it's inductive because I have this function here. So the training, from training, a classifying function is induced, which is just to classify the data. And the archetypical example of this is super vector machines, which you have here on the right. So the classifying function is the orange line here, and we have two types of points and so on. Okay, so I want to see what happens to this very general scheme when I have quantum data, so I'm going to replace the expected by rows, by density matrices. And now the training set is going to consist on pairs of density matrices with associated labels. And I will have some other density matrices that I want to label correctly. So how does the algorithm change? Now I have A, which is quantum input. I put it into a training step. Here, the training step consists of a quantum measurement, M. Measures the training set, and the outcome of the measurement, of course, is classical. And this classical variable determines the classification measurement that I have to perform over the quantum set that I want to label. So here already you see first difference, which is the fact that the outcome of this classification measurement is strongly probabilistic in this case, in the general case, where before it was we had a deterministic application of the function. But most importantly, quantum mechanics has two major implications for this setting. So, in the first place, we can do more than this. We have access to collective coherent operations. So we can actually measure the training set and the test we want to test it. So, I can actually regard the learning protocol as a black box where it's plugging two quantum inputs and I have two possible testing outputs. Okay? And it also comes with a limitation, which is now the training set is quantum, and therefore I can only use it once. Okay. So this is going to be a limitation. And I also want to add here that if you regard this type of protocol in this black box fashion, then it's maybe debatable that you can still call it inductive supervised learning, because you don't have any kind of induction in principle in this, inside this black box. Okay. But I will come to this point anyway. So the question that you ask now, when you have this extra feature that quantum mechanics allows, is okay, but I mean, are they really meaningful? So will I get a sensible advantage out of them? And this problem has been studied in several works, where people considered very similar schemes and contrasted what is called in these works normally semi-classical strategies. That is a strategy that consists in two separate measurements with some classical communication in between, with fully coherent strategies. And okay, these are several works, and you don't have really to pay attention to these images here. But the thing is, they have you have a variety of results. Okay, for some of these settings, you have actually the semi-classical strategies matching coherent strategies in performance, and in some other settings, you don't have this. Okay. And let me just mention the first case, because you can consider this as the precursor of this sort of protocols, which was a work in 2002 by Sasaki and Carlini. And there, the settings are slightly different. It's not binary classification, it's template matching, so the fingerprint is different. But OK, in all the other three cases, we are talking about classification, but depending on the setting and the approach that you use, we have. So at this point, we were wondering, how general is this? I mean, this seems to be very case dependent. So I want to see if there is any general trait of supervised, or a general statement that you can make about supervised learning, inductive supervised learning algorithms, in a fully quantum setup. So for making such a general statement, I have to take a step back and become a little bit more abstract and a little mathematical, not so mathematical. And, okay, so I'm going to begin with the classical case. So this is classical supervised learning. I have a training set, I have a set of n test instances, and I'm going to define a learning protocol via stochastic maps. A stochastic map that just takes as inputs the training set, the test instances, and outputs the set of labels. Okay? So far, so good. It's going to be useful to define marginal maps. So if I take this guy and I just sum over all possible, all the labels that are not yi, then I have the marginal map vi. Okay? This has continued output. And I'm going to define, this is a learning protocol, okay? I'm going to define this protocol as inductive if the stochastic map fulfills this type of non-signaling condition. And what I mean by this is, you take the marginal, so the marginal learning protocol, pi, okay, the one that just labels yi, but depends on all test instances in principle, if this marginal protocol is equal to another one where I replace all other test instances by x, but xi, then I call them up non-signaling. And I claim that this is going to correspond to inductive learning protocols. So two things that you have to keep, or it's useful to keep in mind from this definition, is that each marginal map still depends on training set. Okay, so A is on both sides of the equation. And this definition encompasses what is generally assumed as the definition of inductive learning, which is I take training set, out of it I take a classifying function, and then I apply the classifying function over the test instances, and I get a label. Okay? Such a structure, by construction, fulfills this condition. Okay? We can see it the other way around. For this, I need another ingredient, which is the figure of merit that we use to quantify the performance of these learning protocols, which is going to be the excess risk. It's just this expectation value of my stochastic map P over the unknown probability distribution weighted by some risk function that contrasts two labels, the label that my protocol produces and the true label. Okay? This is the figure of merit I'm going to use for quantifying quality of learning. So, okay, from the condition, from the non-signaling condition that we saw before, you can derive this length. So, for any learning protocol P, there is another protocol P tilde which factorizes in this form. And what it means is Q and T are also stochastic maps, and this is a stochastic map that just takes the training set and produces some function F. And it's just a product of local stochastic maps that takes itself, applies it to itself and the XI, and produces some table Y, some useful inductive sense that we are using. And the lemma says that these two protocols perform with exactly the same expected precision. Okay, this is may seem obvious in the classical case, but when you go to quantum, this is really crucial. Okay. So in words, you can also rephrase this lemma as the following statement. So every conceivable inductive learning protocol can be regarded as a two-phase operation, a training part and a test part. And if you do this, it has no effect on the performance of the protocol. So we have seen that non-signaling is actually a definitory trait of inductive learning protocols. Okay, so we can think of all things are equivalent. And something which is going to be important for later, you can interpret this new learning protocol P-tilde by applying the same marginal protocol on each of the test instances. Okay, which this is what P1 means. This is the marginal protocol over instance 1, if you want. And if you just take this local marginal protocol and apply it to each of the instances. This is what P2 does. Okay. So now we'll go to the quantum setting. What happens? First of all, as I said before, I replace the unknown joint probability distribution, xy, are going to be now bipartite quantum states, rho xy. My stochastic map associated to my learning protocol P is going to be now a quantum channel Q that acts on the A register, this is the register for the training set, and N registers, which are the ones associated to the test instances and maps them to the output registers of labels. If you think of if you're talking about classification, but this is actually more general. Don't pay attention to these details here, but basically, you can take the non-signaling condition that we had before and then you can write on something equivalent for the quantum channel. Okay. So, how does such a learning protocol look in the quantum case? It has this shape. So it's going to be a quantum channel that takes as input train set A and all the X's, and the train set now is going to consist of some quantum state, rho A, whatever. It's going to be completely general, I'm not going to specify it. And I have n copies of bipartite states, rho X, Y prime, and here I'm producing the Y primes as the true labels associated to the X's, okay? Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to send all the Y primes below this dashed line. And this dash line, what it means is that below it is a referee. Okay? Only care about the upper part. I send all the X parts through the quantum channel. I get the output Ys, and then I send again the output Ys to the referee, which performs a local contrasting operation, S. And I'm gonna quantify, the referee is gonna be able to tell me how good did I perform by giving a number to this kind of symmetric risk observation. Okay, as I just mentioned very quickly, this is a very general scheme, and I haven't said anything about the nature of each of these registers, so everything can be quantum, you can have quantum classical or classical quantum. Okay, so this framework includes actually several discriminative and generative quantum number problems. If rho xy is a quantum classical state, so I'm in the case of classification. Okay. I have quantum states with associated classical labels. But I can also have the reverse. Rho xy can be just a classical register, tensors from quantum state rho y, so the channel is going to act on the classical register, and depending on this information, the channel is going to reverse the quantum state rho. And even more generally, I can just look at the problem of taking marginal states rho and map them to bipartite. Okay. The error of this, as I just said, the error of this protocol is going to be quantified by some simple residual observable. Okay. Okay, don't pay attention to much to the details, but the important thing is the risk observable is symmetric, it's a symmetrized observable, and therefore if I take a quantum channel Q and I write down the symmetrized version of the quantum channel, Q bar, now these two guys will have the same Now if I consider that Q is a non-signaling quantum channel, then the symmetrized version of it is also a non-signaling quantum channel. And doing a similar kind of argumentation as we did in the classical case, using the non-signaling condition, you can see that you can express this x-risk as a function of the local marginal quantum channel acting on one single instance. Okay? And here's the crucial difference between the quantum and the classical system. So if I could actually apply this conditional map on a single test instance, on each of them, okay, then I will perform with the same set risk as my original quantum learning protocol. But here's the problem. I mean, each of these guys takes as input one row A, and I assume that I only have one of them. So this map is non-linear, okay, because of the non-chromatic theorem. So this already prevents me of 2 minutes. 3 minutes, okay. So this is the main difference between the classical case. So what you can do, the solution you can use is some form of approximate cloning. You can assume that what the channel is going to do is just to approximately clone the training set and distribute it symmetrically among the test instances and doing some form of approximate protocol. Okay, the question is how well would this approximate protocol be? And if you actually go formal and quantify this, and this is the main result of the paper, you can bound the difference between the original quantum learning protocol and one quantum learning protocol that factorizes in this sense, has this structure, this measures the training set, and has an IID collection of local quantum channels. So you can bound the difference between the SSVC of these two protocols by something that goes to zero with n, where n is the number of test instances. So what it says rhetorically is that you take the original scheme here and you can safely replace it by this one for large data sets. Okay. And alright, so with this I end. This is the take-home message. So despite quantum mechanics allows you to, in principle, do a lot more than in a classical setting, we have seen that the two-phase separation of inductive supervised learning in a training set and a test set is actually pretty natural for learning protocols that fulfill some reasonable assumption, which is that they are non-signaling under the interchange of tests, which is for interesting problems is normal. Okay. This is an immediate conclusion that you get out of it. You have just taken a, in principle, very complicated protocol and mapped them to a really much simpler one, which is a one-way relationship protocol. Such an analysis is easily extendable to quantum revelations instead of quantum states. And, I'm going to not talk about specifically about this unless somebody else because I'm out of time. Thank you.
Insisted that the risk function is symmetric. Is it reasonable to think of non-symmetric risk function? How much will everything change if you start?
Well, I mean, if you wouldn't look into non-symmetric risk functions for protocols that are non-symmetric. You want the protocol to be kind of invariable under arbitrary interchanges between the instances, then the most natural thing to do is consult true and produce labels one by one.
Of course, it's not reasonable.
No, it could be reasonable, but I wouldn't associate a non-symmetric risk function to a non-symmetric quantum channel. This association would be not very natural.
One last question.
Yes, in this case of
quantum algorithms. How did you train your function Q? I mean, what is Q and how would you train in case you want to do some classification?
That would be extremely dependent on the setting that you're looking at. I mean, this is just here for this work, you don't care. This is just a very general quantum channel, and it's a very general statement. And in principle, I've been talking about access risk, which is something that's very hard to access in a practical instance, but still we can make some claims about it, taking the symmetries and the problem into account. But of course, I mean, that would be how to measure the training set specifically and how to extract information from it. What's this measurement aim I was talking about? That would be extremely very dependent.